In the last years, you had a lot of changes in the progress of MOSFET technologies. So when I started in 2005, we were dreaming of having 4 milliohm in a D-PAK. The maximum we could do for 40 volt was 10 milliohm. And this is way, way over time. So every four or five years, we doubled the power densities and we reduced the RDS ons. Now we have to work on the packages because D-PAK, for instance, has about 1 milliohm. If it is empty, already 1 milliohm. So now we are having parts with 0.42 milliohm overall. So in a D-PAK, that would be not doable. We went from 4 milliohm to 0.4 milliohm and basically shrink the package from D-PAK to a 5x6. And what we can do now in a 3x3 is 1.5 milliohm. That's enough for all your applications. The power densities on modern IGBTs are higher than the surface of the sun. And when we are going for silicon carbide, it's even factors 5-6 higher. And when on top of that, when we was working with the optimizing the packages, we came up with new ideas how to cool the whole thing. And that is what we're showing here, the difference between the traditional cooling and the cooling with a top cool system. With a 0.42 milliohm, it's a 420 microohm. This is any screw, every little wire has more than that, every contact. So we are talking about a really crazy low amount of resistance, which then translates in a very low amount of power loss. So you don't have a power loss. Not creating the power loss is always the best thing you can do. We had in the past, we had to use modules for electronic power steering. Now, since 10 years, we are doing it with discretes, and the PCB is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And now you can make really neat and tidy things in the diameter of the motor. That in the past, it was such a box on the top of the motor. Also, we have the traditional way of cooling is you put your aluminium plate below here, and then it will just sink the heat down. And with the top cooled, we're just inversing that whole thing, and we basically pull out the heat from the top. So the cooling plate is then on top of your PCB, and you have the population on the bottom. And that gives you multiple advantages, actually. So first thing is, with this setup, you can even further reduce the RT hedge. So as a rule of thumb, about half, which means half the RT hedge is 4x the current, 4x the power. It's a huge increase in power density. We have done a study here that with 400 or 300 micrometer thickness, we can go as low as 4 kelvins per watt on a 5x6 package. We gain and we lose basically about 2 kelvin per watt if we go to a big, big gap of 700 micro, as a 0.7 millimeter. And most of our customers telling us that they can handle 0.5, 0.3-ish. So that means they have a factor of more than 2 in the heat dissipation gained. And that means 4x the power density. When you populate the backside is cool. So you can put your gate driver right under the top cool and just connect the via. Your loop inductance is incredibly good. It's the best you can do on a PCB. Plus you can look at the passives and basically get one class below, lower in temperature, which helps also. But we have customers who say, no, we don't want to change our factory. We stay with the traditional SO8s with classical cooling. And then we say, okay, then you just buy a bigger die. We can go as low as 0.42. You will not have losses anyway. Yeah. But so we can offer both solutions. So we released now, the 5x6, as a first shot for 40 volt. And we will have the 10x12 for 80 volt then. The gate charge scales with the size of the die. So with every technology, we are shrinking the dies and the gate capacities go down. It's getting easier to drive these parts. but they are, let's say, getting also a bit more nervous to frame it in that wording. So you have to take care on driving it in a clean loop with this top cool concept to have the gate drivers on the bottom. The signals look fantastic suddenly, and you have much less ringing, which also helps you a lot in stabilizing your whole design and getting the thing more. The new gate drivers are really high complex mixed signal parts, which do a lot for you. They detect the Miller depot, they do the DSET functions, everything is built in. When the dice get smaller, your reaction time has to be faster. But that is not a big problem anymore. So the gate drivers will do that for you. You don't need to have a microcontroller loop which looks every 10 milliseconds if the board is exploded or not. It will automatically switch off and protect you. You need to always work on the DVDTs in time, because normally when you do your design, you focus on the losses. So the first thing you do is you make it as fast as you can, and then you have great losses. And you are finished with the design, and then the design goes into the EMI chamber, and then you fail in EMI testing. And that time you are already 6 months from release, and you are in deep shit, and you need to redesign. And so please start thinking about these things earlier. The switching speeds and the, let's say, EMI topics need to be more in focus in the future. Well, I talked a lot about the 0.42 milliohm, extremely low ohmic. The real application usually is not need that 500 amps. So you have a 5 amps, 10 amps, maybe 2 amps load, and then you should see how small you can go with the package. The whole scale moved down. So even the highest RDS on in the package can be enough for you, and more than enough. In the past, basically, the strategy was the part must be rugged enough to do that, and we still have parts like that in our old portfolio, but they are, compared to the new ones, very expensive and very big. Customers want to have small, lightweight, compact designs, and in the end, the physics doesn't change. So if you switch a 10 millihenry coil with 10 amps, you have a certain energy, and you need to get rid of that when you switch it off. And this is something you need to apply clever strategies now. But they are available in the markets. There are white papers on it. It's all under control. But it's really something which changed from the past to now. The switch is no longer just a simple switch. It's more, you need to more think about all the boundary conditions to keep things under control. You have to take care on the layout of your traces. And definitely you need power traces as a 0.35, not a 0.15 signal trace. We are now reaching with the MOSFET an area with 420 micro. That we are already in the same ballpark of a PCB layer. Every screw connection is way, way more, of course. Even a solder tap can be more.